Our Community, Past and Present is sponsored by Rock Hill Coca-Cola Bottling Company, proudly supporting our community since 1906. And now your host, Gary Simrill.
Welcome to Our Community, Past and Present, where we continue to discover the greatness of our community, from our rich history here to our dynamic present. All of those things just tell us what a great future we're going to have. So we're glad you're joining us today. And we also have a special treat, speaking of making the future bright for all of us. And that's recognizing our armed forces, our veterans. We're free because of them today. And we have Ed Egan. Ed, thank you for being here. Semper Fidelis. I'm looking at your shirt. The heroes that help keep America free all of these years. I think sometimes we fail to truly grasp and to recognize the heroic efforts of our veterans here. And so as we look to Veterans Day, November the 11th, this year, 2024, it's a pause and a reflect of the sacrifice. I read once, some gave Correct. Gave all. And here you are, it is not only a testament to the heroism of these United States of America, but upon your return, you stayed involved. And we'll talk a little bit about the things you're doing today that maintains that reflection, honor, memorial of who our veterans were, and more importantly, their legacy as we continue forward. And we think about September 11th and the tagline, never forget. Right. And in reality, we should never, ever forget our veterans and those sacrifices. So thank you for being on the show.
Well, I'm glad to be here. It's an honor, Gary, as a representative for other veterans. But make one thing clear at the start that I'm not a hero. I served with a number of them. But the Marine Corps core values are duty, honor, and country. And those are the things which, during my years in the Marine Corps, which was only 5 years active duty, really coalesced into making me who I have become. I was sort of searching for an identity beforehand, and the challenges in the Corps and in combat crystallized and solidified them so that I finally knew who I was, and the question is, where am I going?
Well, and the humility is there, and it's a real humility, and every veteran I have ever had the pleasure and the honor of speaking with shares that same sentimentality, and it's a ruggedness of who we are as Americans, but recognizing, who we are too as a country. Let's talk a little bit about, because I want our viewers to know about Ed Egan before military service in Vietnam, and then in our next segment, we're really going to get into some of your service, because those actions, what you saw firsthand, I want our viewers to hear. But as you say, growing up in New York, let's hear a little bit about Yankee Ed prior to Vietnam and coming to South Carolina.
Okay. I don't like to talk about myself. But it's, I got here. I was born in the Bronx, New York, Irish Catholic family. I had two brothers and three sisters. I was the third son, the fourth child. And the time and the area in which I grew up was not what people would think of New York City. The city, specifically in the Bronx, is broken up into like essentially ethnic enclaves, like almost every big city has a Chinatown, for example, or Little Italy. But the area of the Bronx that I grew up in was almost exclusively residential, not the kind of homes that we have here and we think about, or what I have lived in and live in now, but duplexes, two-story, two-family homes and this and that. There were tree-lined streets, The street that I grew up on had a huge vacant lot on it that had a hill, and as kids we called it the mountain. And we would climb its trees and have snowball fights and go sledding down there because snow in the winter was frequently enough. And it was the only thing that made winter bearable because, as I told you outside, I used to be a Yankee, but I gave that up a long time ago. I've been in the South permanently since 1978, and very glad I am, although initially it was culture shock. But as I adapted, so too did the South. I think we former Yankees brought some good stuff down here, and we picked up the heart and soul of the good stuff that was already existing. But it was a good, calm area to grow up in, and I was born January 1st, 1944, so I had the benefit of the 50s, which was a wonderful time, you know, except for the Korean War and, of course, the threat of nuclear war. Essentially, though, it was a time of peace. It was a time of calm. We had the greatest music ever. There was no such thing as the helicopter parents. We were pretty much on our own, outside almost all of the time, playing in the street. It was a quiet residential street. We'd be in the middle of the street playing stickball or, you know, other games like that, stoop ball, one called Ring Labial. My neighborhood was an ethnic mix of probably 45% Irish, 45% German, and 10% Italian. And it was a wonderful coalition. And the church, which was a block away, the parish, really was the heart and soul of the neighborhood. It was, it created a community that extended for a radius probably of about five blocks. And it was a great slice of the city, and it was a great time to grow up. Going through grade school, I went to a parochial school. Going through grade school, I was always the youngest, smallest, and smartest boy in my class, so I was bullied a lot. I have great sympathy for kids who get bullied nowadays, I have since, but I won't say I was teacher's pet, but because I was the smartest kid in the class and did the stuff so easily, the teachers would tend to smile at me. And we tended to have rather large classes in a parochial school, maybe about 45 kids in the class. But some of these guys didn't like it, and they might be 2 years older than I was, a foot or two taller, God knows 50 pounds heavier or whatever, and so I was the nerd. And I got bullied, and that had a long-term effect, including, it made me feel, in the beginning, as anyone would, I tried to stand up to the bullies, but after getting beaten into the ground a couple times, I learned to have a quick tongue and fleet feet, and so I'd insult them, and then I'd run for it and usually get away. But that feeling of being a nerd, or more accurately, feeling that I was a coward because I had to run, stayed with me for a long time.
Well, your life after that, though, being in the Marines, when we get into the next segment of things that you saw, that you did.
That was one of the reasons why, Gary.
Well, thank you. Thank you for that service. You know, it's oftentimes in our lives that one moment on one side of us pivots us to something that is a great calling.
Exactly.
So thank you for that. When we come back, I want to talk more about Ed and his days in Vietnam.
Okay.
We'll be right back after these words.
Coke Zero is now Coke Zero Sugar, with great Coke taste. Some people were excited to hear the news, some were skeptical. So we're not going to have the star of the show you're watching come out and say, "You'll love it." No special jingle written by this week's hottest pop star. No famous internet celebs who happen to be holding the label just so. Okay, maybe just one little pour shot. The only thing that will make you believe Coke Zero Sugar has great Coke taste is trying it yourself. Ice cold Coke Zero Sugar. Try one today.
We know the type. You like to start early, finish late, make lemon squares, and make payments to the college fund from anywhere in the house. We know you rely on Comporium for the things you rely on most, like a view of the backyard. That's just a bunny, and hundreds of channels to watch, whenever you want. So you may think of us as just your internet company, But we're more like the, I didn't know they could do all that company. Comporia, always ready.
Being there for someone in their time of need is what Green Funeral Home has done compassionately for four generations. It's a privilege we take very seriously.
We believe each life should be honored and remembered by family and friends. Whether you choose traditional burial in our chapel or another venue, or cremation provided by our on-site crematory, we will help guide you through each step to ensure your needs are met.
We are also available to discuss pre-planning, peace of mind that you have helped your loved one by making those difficult decisions.
When the need arises, our family is here for your family.
When your gutters need repair, call the company that's been providing roofing and gutter services since 1939, H&S Roofing and Gutter Company. We offer full gutter service, from simple repairs to complete replacement, gutter guards, and even gutter cleanings. In fact, H&S Roofing and Gutter Company was voted Charlotte's best gutter service company by the readers of The Observer. When it comes to your gutter needs, call the best. H&S Roofing and Gutter Company, serving the Carolinas since 1939.
Welcome back to Our Community Past and Present, where we continue our conversation with Ed Egan. Ed has been so influential, involved in our veterans in our area. And Ed, hearing your life story, I can't help but think you're growing up in the Bronx. And you said this, a simpler time to grow up, a great time to grow up. And while I didn't witness that, hearing from my family, who did grow up then, although they grew up in the South, it was a great time. And so I was thinking of you telling about being bullied as a younger person. You were smaller but smart, and that really set you up as you then graduated from Holy Cross and started into the Marine Corps and what that meant. Tell us a little bit about that segue going in, and also tell us about, just your thoughts as you entered service, what you were going to be facing. I was thinking if you look at World War II and start comparing that to either the Korean War or Vietnam, the sense of the country had some divide, and you didn't see the unison that you did. So here you are, fighting for your country, for the cause, and you also had those that disagreed and were very loud about it. But as you entered service, tell our viewers a little bit about your mindset, what was going on, and how you worked through that, given, your childhood experiences.
Well, talking about community, I went to a private high school in New York City in Manhattan. And the motto of the school was Pro Deo et Patriae, which means for God and country. And that well described the area and the era in which I grew up. Our church, our parish, was the focus of the community. And my father especially was very involved in the church and in church and social matters related to our faith. So we had that. It was a community of faith and of community, starting with our small enclave in a huge city out to our entire country, coast to coast. And that was the country part. So for God and country made a great deal of sense. And that was the aura in which I grew up. And that stayed with me. The only baggage that I carried going onward was the question, can I hack it? Am I a coward? I run away from bullies, I should stand up to them. Well, my sophomore year in high school, I finally caught up to my current height and never really bulked up. I was not a fighter, but I would fight for what was right, including one time I took on an older kid because he was ragging on my older sister, Meg, and I just went after him. It was a mad dog let loose. So I certainly had the urging to stand up for myself or for others. I had the protectiveness, but I had to be triggered first. And when I was about 12 years old, I decided I wanted to fly. and it would be logical, therefore, go into the Air Force. I wanted to fly jets. I wanted to be a glory guy, fly fighters. When I graduated from high school, I had a couple of academic college scholarships, and I had an alternate appointment to the Air Force Academy. So that would seem a logical career path, but at more or less the last minute, I decided to forego that because I figured I would rather have 4 years of fun in college than have discipline crammed down my throat. You know, I've heard it described as a million-dollar education that you fed nickel by nickel down your throat, and I figured I don't need that. So I went to a private college, and as it turned out, they had Air Force ROTC and Navy ROTC. And I became informed and realized that, gee, the Navy has fighter and attack bomber aircraft too. There's the Blue Angels, and it takes a heck of a lot more to land and take off on an aircraft carrier, so I'll go Navy. So I signed with the Navy ROTC, and as fate happens, and I'm glad it did, I came under the influence of a Marine Gunnery Sergeant who is part of the staff of the Navy ROTC program, because he was coaching the rifle team, and I went out for it, and he taught me how to shoot. He also taught me that, oh, you want to fly, Ed? Well, you know, the Marine Corps has pilots, too. You ever hear of Flying Leathernecks? And that was a movie done in the 40s. Well, yeah. And fly the same aircraft, get the same training, wear the same wings as naval aviators, I could have the best of both worlds. I could be a naval aviator and a Marine Corps officer. So hook, line, and sinker, there I went, and I never regret biting that hook. Upon graduation from college, the year before, between my junior and senior year, I went to OCS down in Quantico, Virginia. Officer Canada School, and that was 8 weeks. And actually, physically, mentally, and emotionally, as we all hear of the horrors of boot camp like a Paris Island, but in fact, this 8 weeks was even more intense because it was compressed, and they were looking to find people who would be and could be leaders, so there was a lot of extra pressure. It was tough, but I made it through it. And one of the reasons I looked to the Marine Corps was to answer that question that had developed when I was in grade school. Can I hack it or am I a coward? And I not only accepted the challenge, I wanted the challenge because I had to find out who and what I was. So I went in after the 6 months infantry officer training school at Quantico as a second lieutenant. I went to flight training in Pensacola, Florida. And I'll get back to that in a minute because something just came to mind.
So we're going to a break in just a second, but when we come back, I want to finish that up because I also, and you did hack it, and I think what an incredible life story you have of service to others and protection of this country. So we come back, we're going to unpack that, but I also want to talk about things you're doing today right in this community that have such an impact for our veterans. We'll be right back after these words.
Coke Zero is now Coke Zero Sugar with great Coke taste. Some people were excited to hear the news. Some were skeptical. So we're not going to have the star of the show you're watching come out and say, "You'll love it." No special jingle written by this week's hottest pop star. No famous internet celebs who happen to be holding the label just so. Okay, maybe just one little pour shot. The only thing that will make you believe Coke Zero Sugar has great Coke taste is trying it yourself. Ice cold Coke Zero Sugar. Try one today.
At Founders, we know your finances matter. That's why we have loans for any reason.
Can Founders help us with our mortgage?
Of course.
Can Founders get me an
auto loan? Not a problem.
Nice.
Can we do something about this?
Home improvements? Absolutely.
How about just getting ahead?
Pay down some bills? We can do that. When you need a loan, our great low rates give you the opportunity to invest in the most important thing, you. So relax. At Founders, we're with you every step of the way.
When a catastrophe hits, it can be a very stressful time for you. When you have trees on your house, when you have trees on your cars, and you don't know what to do, you call us.
We're not a 1-800 number, we're an 803 number. We've been in business for over 60 years because we take care of our clients. That means taking care of them during claim situations.
We're not 9-to-5, we're 24/7. We're gonna be there when you need us most. Gill Insurance, your local auto owner's agent. Understanding business is how we do business.
We know the type. You like to start early, finish late, make lemon squares, and make payments to the college fund from anywhere in the house. We know you rely on Comporium for the things you rely on most, like a view of the backyard. That's just a bunny, and hundreds of channels to watch, whenever you want. So, you may think of us as just your internet company, but we're more like the I didn't know they could do all that company. Comporium, always ready.
Welcome back to Our Community Past and Present, where we continue our conversation with Ed Egan. And Ed, what a fascinating life, from your childhood, growing up in the Bronx, to going to Quantico, really realizing a dream you had of aviation, mm-hmm. and what that turned into. And I know you said you faced kind of that moment where you wanted to make sure you could hack it, and I can tell you from this side, you hacked it okay. You did very well. And so now, Vietnam is starting to ramp up. You finished Quantico. Take us to the next step.
Okay. Well, becoming a Marine was part of the answer to how I had challenged myself. I had to see if I could hack it or not. So that covered, and that was reinforced in the Marine Corps training, including at basic school at Quantico. And then Pensacola, Florida, for flight training was a hell of a lot of fun. It was a challenge, but the fixed wing part of it, where I started out, it just came naturally, I think. Near the end of it, after I had already done my carrier qualifications, landings and takeoffs on an aircraft carrier out in the Gulf of Mexico, normally the next section of the training would be you get your choice and your service makes a selection between fixed wing, like fighters and stuff, or multi-engine, or helicopters. Well, the Marine Corps came to my class and said, we need helicopter pilots, so you don't have a choice, you're all going into helicopters. And at that point, I had been a fairly experienced fixed wing pilot, as I said, already having made my carrier qualifications. So I was dragged into a helicopter pipeline, kicking and streaming. And as it turned out, I was right, because it was an entirely different animal, and I thought I would never learn it. The coordination between feet and hands, the throttle and the collective, and then the stick, all of the different ways of movement. But one day it all clicked, they all fell into place, and got it.
Wow.
And after that, actually, I fell in love with helicopters, probably mostly because of the missions that we participated in that made it real.
So talk about the missions of being on medevac and what you experienced, in Vietnam.
Okay, well, going to Vietnam, it was curious there. There were a lot of guys who were like, rah, 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 I was very quiet because I still had that question in mind. Nobody knows ahead of time really how they're going to react in combat. You face mortal danger, and there's the old fight or flee. And I didn't know whether I would fight or whether I would flee. But again, it was part of that initial question from the bullying when I was a kid. I had to find out, will I fight or will I flee? And so I got to Vietnam in August 1967, joined a squadron of UH-34D helicopters, and that was down by Chu Lai, which was about 40 miles south of Da Nang. We was there for a couple months, and while we were there, we were supporting the Republic of Korea Marines, the ROK Marines, and our own, because we flew from down there all the way up to the DMZ, which was about 90 or 100 miles north of where we started. But after a couple months, our squadron moved north, opened up a new air base in Quang Tri, which was about 10 miles from North Vietnam. And by that time, I had been exposed in a lot of missions. And I found out that I could be afraid, but I could push it aside and do my job. So it answered that part of the remaining question of, am I a coward or do I have what it takes? And medevac missions were obviously to get the wounded off the battlefield, or sometimes there might be a Marine who came down with a heat stroke, a heat exhaustion or something. They had an accident, broke a leg or an arm or something like that. So it wasn't all because of enemy action, certainly, but most of it was. I flew 863 combat missions, and a combat mission is one in which you take enemy fire. So
863
wow. Combat missions, yeah. I learned a lot about myself. I learned a lot about flying a helicopter. I learned a lot about what we were fighting for, and the curiosity is we were not necessarily fighting at that point in our development, our individual development. We were not even necessarily fighting for our country. We were fighting for each other. The Marine Corps and the other services are a brotherhood in a sense. You trust the man on your right, the man on your left, and you won't let them down. It's a matter of that, as I said, the Marine Corps motto, duty, honor, and commitment, or honor, courage, and commitment. Some of the medevac missions were extremely dangerous, and some were heartbreaking. You know, like you risk everything to go in and get a guy out, and then he dies on the way back. We had good medical care over there, field hospitals scattered around, not quite, but almost like what was depicted in the TV series MASH. There wasn't much humor there. Or one of the hospital ships lying a couple miles off the coast, the repose or the sanctuary. And sometimes, like especially critically wounded, say with a head wound, we would bypass the onshore facility and fly them direct out to the hospital ship because they were all set up for that kind of thing. But they, medevac missions tended to be the most dangerous but also the most rewarding, because we were there to save lives. And I'll take that to my grave, that because of me and my crews, there were a number of men who continued to live, got home safe. And I hope it'll amount to enough to forgive all of my other transgressions, but that was the duty and the honor of my life. I don't regret a minute. I would do it all over again. No matter how we may historically judge the Vietnam War and our involvement, the way we who were doing the fighting conducted ourselves was, for the most part, to the utmost degree, a matter of duty and honor. It was not all Lieutenant Kelly in me lie.
I know you don't see yourself as a hero, but from my perspective and those of us that are watching this show, you certainly are.
Me too. It was duty. It was duty.
It is duty. But I want to thank you for committing your life to a better America. Having you on the show today as we look to November 11th, Veterans Day, where we commemorate and honor those that fought, had the commitment, had the duty, had the courage to keep America free. Thank you on behalf of all of us here.
Oh, you're certainly welcome. But please remember that it's not all combat. We have to honor and thank those who served. We used to kid them and say, you know, somebody who's in the rear with the gear. And that may be true as far as the description of their job and everything, but we couldn't do our jobs were not for them. So everyone who took the oath and wore the uniform deserves thanks for honorable service. It does not have to have involved combat. In my case, it certainly did. No.
863 missions. Yeah. I hope you've enjoyed this show today. Please reflect on all the sacrifices our veterans have made to keep this United States of America free. We'll see you next week.